But we need to be careful, just because some of these situations have come up, not to be too quick to pull the trigger on just pronouncing somebody a reprobate. Because you think about it, I mean, there really is nothing worse that you could call someone than a reprobate. I mean, you are just totally rejected of God. And that is going to impact how you deal with that person, how you view that person. If you think that someone is just totally unsavable, I mean, you see the scriptures, you know, do not hate them, Lord, that hate thee. And you see that. So if you're going to go that route with someone, you better be sure and confident that you know that they are who you think they are, but that they are actually a reprobate. And you better, you know, my standard for, you know, pronouncing someone a reprobate is very high. Like there's a very high limit or threshold that they have to cross. I need to see evidence that, like, yes, this is that person. And here's why, especially when it comes like a false prophet type of person. We look at the Apostle Paul. Was the Apostle Paul a reprobate? No, of course not. It's ridiculous to even think that he would be. But when we look at the Apostle Paul's life, and we need to remember this, the things that he did before his salvation, if you just looked at his actions, and if you saw that and said, oh man, that guy is a reprobate, then you need to take a look at yourself and your own pronouncement of who you say is a reprobate. He attacked the church of God. He was an enemy of the church. He would go in pretending to be, you know, a saved person. Oh, hey, brother. And then go in and have those people arrested, because he was going around trying to stop what the disciples were doing. It's pretty bad. And he was witness to murder and covered it up. So he was involved, and he was a Pharisee. You say, oh, well, he's a false prophet then. But no, he wasn't. There's a difference, and here's the key. And this is why it's so hard to determine who a reprobate is and who isn't sometimes, is because the key is it has to do with their heart. The Apostle Paul, and we're going to read this passage again in just a minute, he did it ignorantly. All the sins that he was committing, all these outward signs where someone might say, well, that person's a reprobate because look at what he did. The reason why he wasn't a reprobate is because he literally was thinking that he was serving God, and he was doing this ignorantly in unbelief. He didn't reject the gospel. He didn't reject God. He didn't hear the gospel and just refuse it. He never understood it and knew it. He fought against it, but he did it ignorantly. It means without his knowledge. When you read Romans 1, Romans 1 says, because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God. The reprobate knows God. Amen. They've heard, they've rejected, they hate God. That's the reprobate. There's a big difference between that and someone who just doesn't know better. They don't know God. They've been deceived. There are deceived people all over the world, been deceived by false religions. They've been deceived. They're ignorant of the truth. They're ignorant of salvation. They're ignorant of what Jesus Christ actually did for them. But that doesn't make them a reprobate, because they may be sincere in their belief. Now, that doesn't mean that they're going to go to heaven because they're sincere in their belief, right? They need to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ to be saved. But that doesn't just make them automatically just damned, reprobate, too bad, sorry. People can be saved. People have been saved out of, I believe, every religion, just because they thought they were following truth. And they found out they were wrong about that, even if they spread lies, even if at one point they preached a false gospel. But they did so ignorantly in unbelief. I mean, just because someone was telling people, hey, you need to work your way to heaven. I mean, what happens if you find a Mormon missionary, right? And they're going around, they're trying to spread Mormonism and stuff. And then you preach them the gospel and they get saved. Well, they were preaching and teaching a wrong thing, but they're not considered a false prophet in the sense that the Bible identifies someone as a false prophet in 2 Peter and Jude. Because those are people who are willfully, knowingly wolves in sheep's clothing that are intent on destruction. That's what that person is. They're not just simply deceived. Let's read a little bit about Paul's history. He gives his own history here in 1 Timothy chapter 1. Look at verse number 12. The Bible says, "And I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who hath enabled me, for that he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry, who was before a blasphemer." So he said blasphemous things about God, about Jesus Christ. You hear someone speaking blasphemy against Jesus, don't be just so quick to say, oh, well, they're a reprobate. Just because they say blasphemy. Now, obviously, blasphemy is a wicked sin. It's not some small thing. That's a big deal. That's a major sin. He said, and that's the first thing. It was before a blasphemer and a persecutor. So he's persecuting the church and injurious, like literally causing harm and injury. But I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. He was able to obtain that mercy because he wasn't just intent on destroying God because he, you know, God's people because he hates God. He thought that they were wrong, sincerely. Like he sincerely thought that what he was doing was right and was just deceived by that false religion. And then it says in verse 14, "And the grace of our Lord was exceeding abundant with faith and love, which is in Christ Jesus. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came in the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Howbeit for this cause I obtained mercy, that in me first Jesus Christ might show forth all longsuffering for a pattern of them which should hereafter believe on him to life everlasting." He's saying that he was like one of the things that God was showing with the Apostle Paul being saved is his long suffering. How merciful God really is to allow people to sin and sin and blaspheme and do all of these sins and still have them, give them the opportunity to get saved.